session in the webinar series, Care of Diverse Elders and Their Families in Primary Care, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on health literacy and health disparities. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write them. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of the presentation. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to Stanford GEC at stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. And now the today's session will be presented by Drs. Nancy Hikoyeda and Seema Limaye. Nancy Hikoyeda is Associate Director of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center and a consultant in aging, health, and diversity. She has a BS in education from the University of Utah and an MPH and certificate in applied social gerontology from San Jose State University. She received a Doctor of Public Health degree from UCLA School of Public Health. Dr. Hikoyeda's areas of expertise are ethnogerontology and ethnogeriatrics, issues of aging, ethnicity, and health with a focus on Asian Pacific Islander elders, health literacy, long-term care policies, utilization, and end-of-life issues. She has co-authored and edited numerous curriculum and training materials, as well as chapters on Asian American elders in social work practice with the Asian American Elderly, the Encyclopedia of Aging, Cultural Issues in the End-of-Life Decision-Making, the Handbook of Geriatric Care Management, and Ethnicity and the Dementias. Dr. Hikoyeda is co-chair of the Best Practices Team for the SCC Aging Services Collaborative and services on the Executive Committee, advisor to the SJSU Center for Healthy Aging and Multicultural Populations, emeritus member of SJ Senior Citizens Commission, past president of the California Council on Gerontology and Geriatrics, and retired director of the SJSU Gerontology Program. Dr. Seema Limaye is a geriatrician and palliative medicine physician at the University of Chicago. Her clinical interests include ambulatory and post-acute care, particularly of minority older adults. In 2009, she completed a mini-fellowship on ethnogeriatrics, with particular focus on racial disparities in long-term care. Her medical education interests include interdisciplinary education and ethnogeriatrics. And now I'm going to turn the presentation over to Seema.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome.
Welcome to our discussion on health literacy and health disparities. Our thanks go out to the faculty of the Stanford GEC Faculty Development Program, including Dr. Braddock, Yo, Sylvia Berekny, Cambria Hooper, and for sharing their materials. The learning objectives of our talk today are to define health disparities, identify the link between health literacy and health disparities, define and appreciate the importance of health literacy and its impact on healthcare, discuss strategies to reduce health disparities caused by low health literacy, and these strategies include how to effectively work with a medical interpreter, a simple technique known as the teach-back method to enhance communication during a clinical encounter, and assessing appropriate patient health education handout material. Finally, we will also discuss how to create an office environment that is patient-friendly for low health literacy patients. As we begin the topic of health disparities, there are several key definitions that we will discuss in the next few slides. So we are all on the same page. Bear in mind, there are multiple definitions of the term we will discuss today. While I have chosen the following definitions that are well accepted, you may have had other definitions in mind. Currently, there is no consensus for the definition of health disparity. The definition seems to change based on whatever agency is defining the term, funding opportunities for research within the field, and the political climate. The definition of health disparity that I find useful was published in the 2003 Institute of Medicine report titled Unequal Treatment and adapted from the authors Gomez and McGuire in their article. This pictorial representation helps us conceptualize what a true disparity is. Looking at the light blue and the orange bars, we can think of a health disparity as the difference in quality of healthcare between groups attributable to both the operations of a healthcare system and discrimination. Here are more key definitions of terms that will be referred to today. Again, while there are many different definitions of the terms we will be using during this webinar, here are some commonly accepted definitions. Race can be defined as a socially constructed category based on parentage and physical appearance. Culture can be defined as a way of life of a population, including shared knowledge, beliefs, values, attitudes, rules of behavior, language, skills, and worldview among members of a given society. And finally, ethnic group can be considered a group of individuals with a shared sense of peoplehood based on race, religion, or national origin, now commonly used to refer to a group with a distinctive culture. Take a minute to digest these definitions, and at the end of the session, you may want to further think about them and discuss them as you consider your own interpretation of these terms. As we discuss health disparities, it will be helpful to identify where the disparity is occurring. For that reason, I'd like to mention the two concepts listed here, health status and health care. Think of health status as the health of people in populations. Disparities in health status may have many determinants, as you can imagine. In terms of health care, think about the delivery of healthcare systems and services to people and populations. Now that we have defined some common terms and hopefully have a similar starting point for the concept of health disparities, let's move into discussing how extensive disparities are, why they might exist, and what provider and patient perceptions of this issue are. The Institute of Medicine published an extensive review of over 100 studies that assessed racial and ethnic variations in a range of clinical procedures. The overwhelming evidence clearly shows that disparities exist in these areas. Quote, the preponderance of studies find that even after adjustment for potential confounding factors, racial and ethnic disparities in cardiovascular care remain. Disparities persist even after accounting for socioeconomic status, access to care, ability to pay, insurance coverage, patient preferences, refusal rates, overuse of services by whites, age, gender, and other clinical factors, comorbidities, disease stage, and availability of procedure. There are many examples of research findings in health disparities of many different disease processes that could be found in the Institute of Medicine report that go beyond cardiovascular research. For example, Zarati and their group looked at African American and white patients in a managed care setting in 1998. African American patients were more likely than whites to access care in the emergency room. They were hospitalized more often. They were less likely to be seen by asthma specialists, less likely to use prescribed inhalers, and conversely, more likely to use oral corticosteroids. I can provide you with more examples from the cancer and psychiatric literature, and certainly we will provide a bibliography at the end of the discussion. Knowledge of why health disparities exist is limited. There are complicated interrelationships between race and ethnicity and socioeconomic status that may result in healthcare disparities. While we may have sufficient data on racial disparities by race and ethnicity, it is difficult to tease out the individual contributions of race, income, or education to these differences. For example, looking at a smoking cessation support study, fewer smoking cessation programs were offered to minority patients. However, we cannot determine how much these differences are affected by different levels of patient income, education, or types of insurance. While the relationships between these factors may seem theoretical, a better understanding of the underlying factors that result in disparities might better target improvement efforts aimed at reducing disparities. Further research may help sort out these issues for future reports. Let's discuss further in the next slide. Some potential explanations for why health disparities might exist include the following. Actual clinical differences. Remember, the Institute of Medicine report some contributions have been accounted for. Ability to pay. Recall that in the Institute of Medicine report, some contributions have been accounted for. However, status does impact healthcare disparities. And VA studies often show less disparity. But in most studies, disparities persist even after adjustment for income, insurance status, and type of insurance. So as we look at the third item, patient and provider interaction, some data support this explanation that differences in patients' preference for health care, that there are differences, and that disparities persist even after adjusting for clinical characteristics. However, there is a continuing debate on the clinical relevance of race and ethnicity. So this reason may be true, but there is not enough data in this area. Some data to support the explanation in terms of the differences in patient-provider communication. But these are mixed results that we will discuss further. And then discrimination, racial bias, and stereotyping. These are true differences to discuss. This is the most substantial explanation, and we will discuss an article that supports this theory. First, let's look at what providers think about disparities in healthcare. Most of the research has been done with physicians, and I do not have data on comparable information about providers in other disciplines. Most physicians do not feel that people are treated unfairly in the healthcare system based on racial or ethnic background. We need to reflect on whether this and consider is this concerning. 55% of physicians polled said that they feel that the healthcare system rarely or never treats people unfairly based on racial or ethnic background, and 14% of physicians said that they never did. Well, now let's look at the flip side. 29% of physicians say that the healthcare system was very or somewhat often treats people unfairly based on their race and ethnicity. But minority physicians have a very different perspective. African-American physicians, and to a lesser extent Latino physicians, are more likely than white and Asian physicians to believe that disparities in care happen very often or somewhat often, particularly in the case of unfair treatment based on race or ethnicity. 77% of African-American physicians and 52% of Latino physicians say unfair treatment based on race or ethnicity happens at least somewhat often, compared to 33% of Asian physicians and 25% of white physicians who say this. Doctors who say racial and ethnic disparities happen at least somewhat often are more likely to say that a lack of doctors in minority communities and communication difficulties are the primary reasons. Doctors are more likely than the public to believe that too few doctors being available in minority communities is a major reason for unfair treatment based on race or ethnicity. In contrast, the public is more likely than doctors to believe that it is related to doctors' assumptions about minorities' ability to pay. Let's take a moment to explore the patient perspective. This table clearly delineates that patients are more likely to report communication challenges and do perceive disparities in their own health care. African American patients are more likely to feel that their provider did not listen, that they are less than they have less than desired involvement in their health care, and that race affects their health. As we discuss the patient perspective, consider that many racial and ethnic groups, as well as poor and less educated patients, report poor communication with their physicians, more problems with some aspects of the provider-patient relationship, greater difficulty accessing health information, including information about prescription drugs. In addition, Black, Hispanic, and Asian elders wait longer to see their providers, are more likely to have hospitals or emergency rooms as their usual source of care. And to me, it's interesting that the providers and patients have different viewpoints on this issue of healthcare disparities, yet I think it speaks volumes to the fact that these problems are complex and multifaceted. This is an example of just one provocative study that examines true racial and gender bias. This landmark article was published by Schulman and his group and was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 1999. It created quite a stir in the press. In this study, Schulman and his group developed videos using actors to standardize the presentation of chest pain. The goal was for these actors to portray patients with similar characteristics but different gender and race. Panel A shows a 55-year-old Black woman, Panel B a 55-year-old Black man, Panel C a 55-year-old white man, and Panel D a 55-year-old white woman. Every patient has similar facial expressions, dress, and symptoms. Physicians viewed videotapes, made recommendations for chest pain, and gave their thoughts about the patient. Some of the patient characteristics they reported included over-reporting of symptoms, how likely the patient is to over-report their symptoms, miss follow-up appointments, participate actively in their treatment, and sue for malpractice. The findings revealed that catheterization referral rates differed significantly. Black patients were less likely to be referred for catheterization referral than white patients. Women were less likely to be referred than men. And in a combined analysis, black women fared the worst as compared to white males. Only 79% of black women were referred for cardiac catheterization as compared to 71% of white men, white women, and black men. Also striking were the physician's perception of the patient's personal characteristics. Physicians were more likely to attribute negative personality traits to black patients than women. These findings show that at an attitudinal level, providers in the study had different views of their patients based on race and gender. Physicians reported that black women were more likely to overreport symptoms, white women were more likely to comply with treatment, and white men were more likely to sue. Now that we've discussed provider bias contributing to discrimination and health status, let's shift gears a bit. Consider this concept of healthcare disparities. What happens to vulnerable minority adults attempting to navigate the U.S. healthcare system? How does the delivery system affect disparities in healthcare? There's very little literature on healthcare disparities for older populations other than for African Americans. In a recently published national analysis of disparities among Medicare enrollees, which should have given us a lot of good information about older adults in various populations, the authors explain why they only included African Americans and whites. Quote, "Separate analysis of the Hispanic population are challenging because fewer than half of self-designated Hispanics are coded as such in the Medicare data. Hispanics constitute less than 6% of the elderly population. They are highly clustered in a few communities. And although racial designation for Asians and American Indians is more accurate, their small numbers, less than 3%, also limit the precision of race-specific analysis," end quote. They go on to note that, quote, "We therefore restricted the analysis in the current report to blacks and non-blacks. And for the ease of exposition, we refer to the non-black population as white," end quote. "It is important to remain cognizant of the fact that in many cases, the term minority refers to African Americans. Often the information in the other designated minority category populations are missing or do not show a difference." The one exception is the National Health Disparities Report for 2003 and 2007, which cover the four minority populations for all ages in most cases. But for some conditions, the comparisons use Medicare data. We know that there are a wide range of services that are less available for minority older adults. Some examples include eye examinations for patients with diabetes, beta blocker treatment after a myocardial infarction, and follow-up of hospitalization for mental illness. Why is geriatric care not available for many American Indian elders? Indian health services was not available in most urban areas, is underfunded, and does not emphasize geriatric and long-term care. Some tribes do fund long-term care, though. From the 2008 Healthcare Disparities Report, we know that the rate of leg amputation is 3 times greater in African Americans and Hispanics with diabetes compared to non-Hispanic whites. In this case, the disparity is more procedure rather than less. Blacks with diabetes were less likely to receive annual hemoglobin A1Cs than whites, but the difference between blacks and whites varied across states. Another health care delivery system commonly utilized by older adults is long-term care, and that too has proven system-wide disparities. Studies looking at long-term care facilities reveal that blacks are concentrated in a smaller proportion of long-term care facilities. They are more likely to occupy Medicaid facilities with deficiencies. They are more likely to live in understaffed facilities, and that long-term care facility racial segregation has been well documented in cities such as Chicago. The health status of minority older adults within skilled nursing facilities also has well documented disparities. Based on the Medicare and Medicaid data, the 2007 disparities report by Agency for the Healthcare Quality and Care found that among nursing home residents, Hispanics, Asian Pacific Islanders, and African Americans were more likely to be in restraints compared to non-Hispanic whites. I've listed several other conditions that have been published in the literature, including disparities in the development of pressure ulcers, disparities in the treatment of diabetes, assessment and treatment of vision loss, treatment for secondary prevention of stroke, and the use of advanced care planning. Now that we have outlined health and healthcare disparities amongst minority older adults, what can we do about it? A deeper look at the components of effective ethnogeriatric care is needed. Obviously, availability of culturally competent providers who are also able to work effectively in multidisciplinary teams is essential. Furthermore, the organizational system has to be committed to placing an emphasis on supporting providers and older minority patients. Enhanced communication skills are essential for geriatric patients in particular. Our geriatric patients are at high risk for cognitive impairment, impaired sensorium, low functional health literacy, and they tend to have complicated medical history with multiple chronic medical problems and complex medical regimens. I will now turn over the next slide to Nancy to discuss some important members of the ethnogeriatric team.
Thank you, Seema. Disparities Solutions Center at Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston, affiliated with Harvard and funded by Robert Wood Johnson, recommends the inclusion of members that serve the function of cultural liaison in those healthcare teams to make them more culturally competent. These are individuals who can provide a liaison between the mainstream health providers and the older patients from diverse cultural backgrounds. The terminology used for these roles has not been totally settled yet, but some commonly used terms that you may come across are the following. One are the cultural navigators, who are generally individuals who can assist individuals through the complex healthcare system. Many times they are used in cancer treatment and screening programs. The University of California Davis Hospital developed a transcultural and linguistic care nursing program where nurses who are fluent in the most common languages of their patients, in this case Spanish, Russian, and Hmong, would assist up to 10 patients a day and stay with them from admission to discharge. In one case, a Hmong patient was considered by the doctors and nurses to be non-compliant because he had refused to take his medication for 3 days, which also resulted in his failing a swallowing test. When the TLC nurses talked to the patient, she learned that he preferred to take his medication after the meals and with hot water or tea instead of taking them with ice water before meals as he had been given. Promotores is another term, a name that is given to health educators in the Latino communities who frequently work with health promotion programs such as for diabetes. They are usually recruited from the community and are not health professionals but lay people, sometimes with a high school education, and they're trained to do outreach and health education for patients with diabetes, and they also educate providers about the problems and barriers that patients face. They're a unique group of people because they have the ability and they're trained to go into the homes and work very closely with the Latino patients and their families. Another variation on this was reported by Alex Green at Mass General. They call their liaison person a health coach. And this coach was bilingual but not from the community. And they use the telephone outreach as he uses an approach to identify their explanatory model and the barriers and the fears before making referrals. They were able to reduce the hemoglobin A1C measures of Latino and white individuals with over an 8.0 value to they were able to reduce it a mean of 1.4 points. So they were very effective as health coaches. Community health workers play a similar role. They are usually recruited from the community and work or volunteer with the healthcare system to provide interpretation, culturally appropriate health education, and informed counseling and guidance on health issues. The Indian Health Service has used community health representatives as a very important component of its services, especially in remote reservations where they are the face of the Indian Health Service. And they do home visits for screening and health education and provide transportation to clinics that are sometimes hours away. Cultural guides or cultural brokers are less well-defined, and there are many case examples of providers using liaison people from the community to help solve particular issues with patients from specific cultures where there may be a problem with communication or a misunderstanding. So what else can be done to reduce health disparities? Well, one thing is to improve health literacy of our population. In today's context, we will use the most comprehensive definition of health literacy, which is the wide range of skills and competencies that people develop to seek out, comprehend, evaluate, and use health information and concepts to make informed choices, reduce health risks, reduce inequities in health, and increase their quality of life. It is startling to note that over 90 million people in the United States have low health literacy. Sorry, I forgot about that. There are many different aspects to health literacy. Today, it allows individuals to interact with the world in numerous ways. This slide shows the many domains of health literacy, and these include reading, writing, speaking, and numeracy. Numeracy refers to working with numbers, balancing checkbooks, writing checks, paying bills, doing calculations, reading nutrition labels, and doing measurements, those kinds of things. Patients can succeed or fail in any of these areas, and much of this is dependent on how and what we are taught in school. Science literacy refers to levels of competence with scientific and technological information, including some awareness of the process of science. For example, what do you do when a patient brings you a newspaper clipping from the New York Times or something printed from the Internet that involves cholesterol-lowering drugs or antipsychotic medications in dementia use? Scientific information also changes. For example, hormone replacement therapy, or how much red wine can a person drink? Cultural literacy refers to the ability to recognize and apply beliefs, customs, and social identity to interpret and act on health information, so the cultural issues that determine how a person behaves. It includes awareness of different cultural interpretations and the ability to communicate and interpret across cultures. For example, what do you do when a patient believes that the color of a medicine is important, or that prescription labels are suggestions, or has no knowledge of the difference between a tablespoon or a teaspoon, or thinks that medicines are made for adult body sizes alone, or envisions a chronic disease as a series of distinct illnesses like asthma, or considers an illness as a good omen? Civic literacy refers to abilities that enable people to be aware of public issues and to be actively engaged in decision-making and responding to public health or other health issues. Included are media literacy skills, knowledge of civic and government processes regarding health or health care, advocacy skills, and an awareness that individual health decisions impact public health. Here you see the complex interfaces of health literacy in medicine today, where we have a major emphasis on patient-centered care. Patient-centered care means that the patient is an active participant in his or her medical care, rather than simply a receiver of information or someone who is simply told what to do. Let's look at some concrete examples. We are bombarded with health information from numerous sources, magazines, newspapers, television, etc. But how reliable are these sources? How capable is the average patient to know whether the information is accurate or will be helpful? Bureaucratic forms, such as health insurance forms, can be daunting. And now we know there may be penalties for filing incorrect forms. We also have to face office registration forms and questionnaires about past medical history and many other types of forms related to healthcare delivery. Patients are encouraged to practice health promotion and disease prevention, to ask themselves, what do I need to do to stay healthy? How do I change my lifestyle, such as diet or activity, in order to maintain health or prevent chronic conditions? Patients are also expected to treat their own chronic diseases and practice self-management skills and self-medication, and often with the use of technology or medical equipment. Communication with healthcare providers in acute care hospitals, doctors' offices, labs are also key. How does communication occur, and what is the quality of the encounter? And finally, it is well documented that medical errors can cause death, raise medical costs, or have other debilitating consequences. Health literacy is more than a predictor of individual behavior. Health literacy by itself is a complex social determinant of health, along with low income and poverty, the amount of social support that's available or not available, employment or working conditions, the physical environment, and the health system performance. Thus, we can see that we should not blame the individual or patient for many health problems or non-adherence, as health literacy may also be a cause. Here we see some of the outcomes of low health literacy. People with low health literacy use screening and preventive services less. They present for care with later stages of disease. They are more likely to be hospitalized. They may have poor understanding of treatment and their own health. They adhere less to medical regimens. They do have increased healthcare costs and increased mortality. That is, they may die earlier. So there are many studies supporting these findings in the literature. A number of risk factors have been identified for low health literacy. One is older age, particularly among the current cohort of older adults. Low income or poverty, as we've discussed before. Low health literacy is more common among those who did not complete high school. But recent research also shows that low health literacy may be found in individuals who have experienced a poor quality education as well. Also, minority ethnic group members, particularly disadvantaged Hispanic and African Americans, are at higher risk for limited health literacy. And recent immigrants who do not speak English are at greater risk, and we know that many immigrants may be illiterate in their native languages. And even among individuals born in the United States, if English is their second language or is not spoken in their homes, they may experience or be at risk for low health literacy. How do we know if someone has low health literacy? Some indicators may be noted on observation, and this slide gives you some clues. They may have incomplete or inaccurate office or hospital registration forms. There may be an inability to give a coherent, sequential past medical history. They may have frequent missed appointments, laboratory, or other test procedures. Or they may be someone who makes excuses in response to written information that is given to them, such as, "Oh, I forgot my glasses. I'll read it when I get home." Or, "Can you read it for me?" Or they may say, "Let me take this home and discuss it with my children." Or when you hand them something, their eyes may wander over the page and they may look very confused. Also, medication problems are a very common indicator of low literacy. And these include the inability to name their medications, their purpose, or their dosing, how often they're supposed to take them and when. Patients may say they are taking their medications, but there is no change in their symptoms. Or they may identify pills not by their names, but by their color or their appearance and not the information on the label. So they may say, "I take the white pill in the morning and the blue pill in the afternoon." These are not to create stereotypes, but they may be indicators of low health literacy. So this slide lists the various formal health literacy assessment tools in use today. The NAL is a national survey instrument used to collect national data. It is proprietary, very long, and you will never use it in practice. The following are available in your handouts, which can be downloaded with the slides for this presentation. The Rapid Estimate of Adult Literacy in Medicine, or REALM, was the first validated tool to be developed. It consists of simply reading a list of words with no measures of understanding or knowledge. It's simply reading the words. There is a new version called the REALM-R, which is shorter, 9 words, and somewhat more accurate. It's easier to use, and it's now available in Spanish as well as English. The TOFLA, or the Test of Functional Health Literacy in Adults, is a little more complex. It consists of a fill-in-the-blanks format with multiple-choice questions and some added numeracy skills. It is more accurate, but lengthy to use and analyze. Oops. The NVS, or Newest Vital Sign, consists of answering questions and interpreting a sample nutrition label. It can be pretty complex if you know what nutrition labels look like. The 3 screening questions are part of the single item question screener, and any one of them can help to identify patients with low health literacy. The 3 questions are, how often do you have someone help you read hospital materials? Or number 2, how often do you have problems learning about your medical condition because of difficulty understanding written information? Or the 3rd question, which has been the most successful in clinical practice, is, how confident are you when filling out medical forms by yourself? The Ask Me 3 are actually 3 questions that a patient should be taught to ask. whenever they see a healthcare provider. And these three questions are, what is my main problem? What do I need to do? And why is it important for me to do this? And personal observation, again, is frequently an accurate indicator of low health literacy. It's sort of an intuitive kind of thing. How do you find out? By talking to a patient about their health literacy levels. Well, some ways to bring up the topic or to approach the patients are to ask very simple kind of leading questions. And here are some samples, just three examples. What things do you like to read? Or we need help fixing the information we give to people, to our patients. How do you think we could make this better? Or how about asking a patient to read the prescription bottle and tell you what it means? These are some non-threatening questions you might ask to further investigate literacy level, and I'm sure you can think of many on your own as well. So what are the different types of healthcare messages that are out there? To improve low literacy, there are many ways to deliver healthcare messages. One is oral, and oral communication will be discussed by Dr. Limaye in a few minutes. The other is written or printed information, such as fact sheets, brochures, booklets, signs. But remember, they must be in plain language and include interaction of some kind. Visual messages include simple illustrations that explain things or tell a story. They may be graphs or tables, posters, signage, games, for people who need to see information and that can reduce the reading, the amount of text for poor readers. And they frequently represent action or movement. Technological methods of healthcare messages include televisions, videos, audio tapes, CDs, and DVDs. These are not commonly used yet, but are gaining in popularity, and particularly for use with older adults. They can incorporate interaction and use redundancy, but they need training and skills to use effectively. I always think of the Wii equipment. Many, many older adults in senior centers and other places, nursing homes, are using the Wii equipment for exercise and things. And then finally, there are multimedia or combination messages. And multimedia include sight and sound and interaction. They're combinations of all of the above. The more non-traditional messages can be particularly effective with ethnic minority elders or those who do not speak English or individuals from other cultures. In your handouts, you have a sheet on tips on how to produce different types of messages that may also be found in your handouts. So improving oral communication is another way to improve health literacy, and the use of interpreters and translators is another. And Seema will talk about these.
Thank you, Nancy. Just to diverge for 1 second and tell you about how important health literacy is in the literature, in this week's Annals of Internal Medicine, one of the lead articles was Low Health Literacy and Health Outcomes, an Updated Systematic Review. So this is very sort of up-to-date stuff that we're talking about and really does affect patient care. I'd like to talk a little bit about the teach-back method. It's the preferred method to confirm understanding of information, and its use is advocated by the National Quality Forum and the AHRQ. The teach-back method is a technique to improve communication and confirm understanding among individuals with limited health literacy. It asks the individual patient to recall or explain, in their own words, what has been discussed. Now, one way to sort of frame this is to ask the patient, I always ask my patients to repeat things back to me to make sure I explain things correctly. I'd like you to tell me how you're going to take the new medicine we discussed today. The teach-back method should not add more than a few minutes to the clinical encounter, and it really does help in ensuring that the patient has a good sense of what the plans are based on the visit. One study was done at UCSF in which the study the lead authors audio-taped visits between 38 physicians and 74 English-speaking patients with diabetes and documented low functional health literacy. These were patients that had a grade 4 to 6 reading level. The study found that 124 new concepts were covered in 61 of 74 encounters. Physicians assessed recall and comprehension in only 20% of the visits. Of those 20% in which recall was assessed, 92% of those patients had a hemoglobin A1C less than 8.6 compared to the patients who did not have the teach-back method used during the clinical encounter. The teach-back method, as I mentioned, should really not add more but a few minutes to the visit. And it begins with the clinician explaining a new concept, then assessing patient recall and comprehension, after asking the patient to do this, the clinician can then clarify and tailor the explanation. Again, reassess patient recall and comprehension, and the goal, hopefully, is that the patient recalls and comprehends the information and is more medically adherent. It's not recommended going through this cycle more than once, which involves two teach-backs. After that, patients seem to become more frustrated. Now that we talked a little bit about the teach-back method, let's discuss trained medical interpreters. Guidelines for trained medical interpreters and behaviors that you should be looking out for are interpreters that listen attentively in one language, repeat the original message accurately and completely in another language without adding, omitting, or changing key information or the intended meaning. Interpreters are ethically bound to repeat everything. They utilize note-taking when appropriate. There's recommended optimal positioning in the way that patients, interpreters, and physicians are seated or standing. And they also are ethically bound to remain confidential, keep the information confidential. The healthcare provider's role in preparing and during the interpreter encounter includes guiding the medical encounter as well as evaluating the quality of the interpreting and directing of the conversation. In preparation for the appointment, if the healthcare provider is aware of the necessity for a trained medical interpreter, the provider should also request an interpreter for the visit. Prior to the medical discussion, the provider should introduce the interpreter to the patient, clearly describing that the interpreter will interpret the upcoming encounter accurately. These steps are essential if any of the parties are new to the patient visit. Healthcare providers can greatly enhance interpreted encounters by following these guidelines. It is important to look at and speak directly to the patient, not the interpreter. Speak in short sentences and pause for interpretation to allow the interpreter to repeat what has been said. Try to use an even pace and normal tone of voice. Always remember that some patients may understand some English, but may be more comfortable talking about sensitive medical topics in their native language. An older psychology study describes the influence of how a message is perceived, with 55% influenced by body language, 38% tone of voice, and only 7% of the words we say. This is a good reminder that anyone who uses poor communication and inadequate language skills compromises quality care. Interpreting is a learned skill developed by bilingual people through formal training. And the problems that may arise with using an untrained interpreter may include that the untrained interpreter is not familiar with medical terminology. They may lack adequate language skills. They may omit, add, or change the message. They may not be familiar with HIPAA or how to respect confidentiality rules. They may not be familiar with patients' rights and may want to make important decisions for the patient. As you can imagine, this could create quite a conflict. And within family units as well, conflicts may arise. Using children as medical interpreters can be very inappropriate. The information that is being discussed may not be appropriate. It may conflict with the family dynamics and the roles. It really places children in awkward situations, and there may be trauma experienced by the child due to the gravity of the discussion. Additionally, it creates a conflict of roles within the family in other ways. Some considerations include elder abuse. If a family member is interpreting, the patient who is experiencing the elder abuse may not feel comfortable discussing his or her problems. There are some problems that have been observed with untrained interpreters, including ad hoc interpreters, bilingual staff, family members, and children as interpreters, that show that up to half of the words are interpreted incorrectly, and there's more potential for mistakes with clinical consequences, and the overall quality of care is reduced for limited English speaking patients with untrained interpreters. Also consider the social and psychological barriers when discussing sensitive issues that may affect the patient if an untrained interpreter is used. Appropriately and effectively written health messages also contribute to improved health literacy. And now that we've discussed oral messages, Nancy will now move on to written messages.
Everyone can hear me now. Just very briefly, I want to discuss some of the assessment tools for written health messages. And you have these in your handouts, so I won't spend a lot of time on them. Three widely used assessments have been effective in determining the appropriateness of written health messages for low literacy individuals. Attribute checklists allow you to evaluate written criteria based on organization, style, appearance, and appeal. They're easy to use because it really is just a checklist that you take your material and you just check off the different criteria. Readability formulas take a little more time, but they're used to assess the grade level of written text based on word difficulty, length of sentences. And the three most commonly used ones are the SMOG, the FRI, and your Microsoft Word grammar and spell check functions. And you also have handouts about this information. Finally, there's the suitability of assessment of materials instrument, the SAM, which is used for printed materials, illustrations, videos, and audio tapes, and has been validated with different ethnic materials. And all of these are explained in more detail in your handouts. More importantly, there are some ethnogeriatric considerations for health information. So when you are creating materials for people from different cultures or who speak different languages, these are very important. First of all, messages should be culturally appropriate. They should be sensitive to taboo topics, the beliefs, the attitudes, the values, the diet preferences, those kinds of things to be more culturally appropriate. The messages should use familiar and acceptable language, images, and examples. more than just text. Written messages should be translated, if appropriate, and pilot tested. Excuse me. Remember, some immigrants may be illiterate in their native tongue, or there may be no written language, so translations in those cases wouldn't really help. And finally, you should consider utilizing principles of clear health communication, information that is simple and clear. Some other considerations are the education level and the ability to read and write of the people that you are targeting your messages for, whether or not they have an individual or a family orientation. Many times messages shouldn't be targeted directly to the individual, but would be more effective if targeted to the family. The community support should be solicited. That is, input and assistance from key informants and those cultural navigators, those people that we identified earlier as being important as cultural liaisons. The use of indigenous communication methods should be considered. In Hispanic and some of the other cultures, they use booklets like photo novellas, which are not text with information, but more visual with pictures that tell a story. Or there may be narratives or other types of visual representations for your messages. And you should also consider multiple message strategies through appropriate channels. And by channels, I mean, how are you going to deliver that message? For example, should it be a computerized message that you want to use? But what about if the elders don't have computers? So consider your channels. There are some caveats for translated written materials. First, it should be fifth or sixth grade education level so that it reaches the widest population possible. You should consider that many times literal or word-for-word translation is not appropriate. It's sometimes phrases or other types of meanings that are more meaningful in delivering your message. We should have an awareness of within-group variation. For example, Spanish speakers may come from many different cultures or different countries and regions and have different dialects. So it is not necessarily a one Spanish-speaking text for all groups. It's always a good idea to pilot test whatever materials you've created in the community itself, and then to evaluate it to make sure that the correct or appropriate message was relayed. And finally, this last slide, just general overall advice for creating effective written healthcare messages for older adults in general. And I'll probably leave you to look at this yourself. But the key phrase here, these are different kinds of things that you should consider, like realistic objectives, focus on behaviors and skills and less on facts. But the key message here is that an older learner must understand what to do and then feel enabled to take action. So, as we said earlier, just reading is kind of a passive learning process. It's more important to incorporate in whatever message you create some type of interactive or experiential activity so that the older learner can feel enabled to take action. And last but not least is sort of an environmental assessment for health literacy. If you are in an office or a hospital or somewhere, the administrative and administration and the staff must also do an assessment. Try to have bilingual staff if you have a lot of bilingual or monolingual patients or clients. Be sure to convey an attitude of respect and understanding, especially if you know someone has low health literacy. To provide assistance with forms, and to provide telephone assistance. Usually live people is the best approach, in some focus groups that I've been involved with, the people who did not speak English said that telephone trees drive them crazy, that they can't understand because the speakers talk so fast, and then they don't understand push one, push two, what have you. If you work in a large facility, make sure the signs are readable, that they facilitate the patients or the clients finding their way or wayfinding, that they facilitate accessibility to the facilities, that information is posted in different languages or with universal symbols, and to develop other policies that will help people who have low health literacy. So we would like to thank you for your participation today. We have tried to present some very basic information on health disparities and to show a connection to low health literacy. Please feel free to contact us for further information or if you have additional questions that we're not able to address today. And we thank you for your presence, and please be sure to complete the survey before you leave, as our funding is dependent on this information. So we do have a few minutes for questions, and please write your questions in the little box, and we will try to answer them. Thank you again.
Okay, thank you. What would you recommend to patients to be proactive in order to ensure comprehension during office visits with doctors and health professionals? At my institution, currently the nurses have been charged with informing every patient that they should be able to ask me three, that it's their responsibility, that they have a right to know. Sort of what Nancy had mentioned, the ask me three questions, and I'm going to read them verbatim here. But patients should understand, you know, what medical condition they have and why it's important and what they can do about it. And so that's one of the initiatives that's taken place at our institution, is that every patient is informed that that they should be asking their providers, what is my main problem? What do I need to do, and why is it important for me to do this? And there are actual buttons that the nurses wear that say, ask me three.
I don't know, Vinny. Do you? I know there's lots of different types of trainings available. For example, online. And we have given you some of those websites on the reference pages. But actual funding, I'm not sure. I don't know of anything in particular myself. Perhaps someone in the audience could give us some information. So that's a good point. Guanyo said that some insurance plans reimburse for interpreter services. Do you see any other questions?
One question is back to the geriatric care research. It has been my personal experience that residents are predominantly white. Is there truth this, and how would it factor into the research points presented? I think conventional wisdom was that most nursing home patients are white, but I think I don't have the data in front of me, but we know that the face of the older American adult is changing, and that the growth of ethnic minority adults is rapidly changing, and that as acculturation is also increasing, it's going to change the demographics of what a quote-unquote typical nursing home patient looks like. So I think further studies really do need to be done looking at how ethnogeriatric care can be better embedded into the long-term care facility culture.
If I might interject, I think one of the issues in long-term care facilities is that the residents are white, but frequently the workers and the staff are not. And so there may be issues, communication issues. Well, I'm not, there may be. There are frequently communication issues in long-term care facilities because of that. So it may take a lot of education, particularly of staff people, in methods of communicating with their clients and their patients.
Okay, if there's no more questions, I'm going to wrap it up. This is Christopher Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on health literacy and health disparities. I'd like to thank the presenters, Drs. Hikoyeda and Limaye. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to get funding. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, August 25th, 11 a.m. Pacific Time. It will be on arthritis and presented by Drs. Eswar Krishnan and Kate Lorig. Thank you so much for your participation, and I'm signing out.